to let you know that with the ESSER II grant, we did bring in some reviewers that you are most likely familiar with. Diane Steamer is going to be reviewing half of the grants, and Karen Kentfield is going to be reviewing the other half of the grants. If Dottie can share her screen, I think she has a PDF that will show which ESUs they will be reviewing. You can still contact any of us if you have questions, but if you get emails from Diane or Karen, just wanted you to know that they are back, at least for a couple months, just to review these grants. So here's the list of the different ESUs that they will be reviewing. And so if you have a problem with a grant or it gets returned, you'll work with Karen or Diane to get that resubmitted.
Very good. Okay. Okay, so we are today hoping to walk you through the grant itself so we can help support that. What we will do as we walk through that is literally walk from left to right in the tabs. If you have questions, I would encourage you to put those in the chat. Ann Hubble from our team will be monitoring that chat. And after we get through a certain tab, she will ask questions that pertain, or she will share the questions if they pertain to that tab. And then Beth and Kirk are also monitoring that, and they may just respond in the chat prior to it being read out loud. So we welcome questions. What we'll do is we'll walk through the grant first, and then for those of you that have additional questions afterwards, we can do them in whole group, or we can go into breakout sessions. So that's why we ask you to rename yourself, so Rhonda could hopefully put you with some of your colleagues in that same area, or at least one of your the reviewers from NDE. So we're glad you're here today. We want to make this process pretty seamless for you in regards to figuring out how to complete this application. We don't want to stump anybody. This isn't stump the chump. This is let's get this done and let's get it done right. So what I'm going to do is the first thing you need to know is this is in the grants management system. That is where you're going to go to get this grant. I'm in a test site, so just ignore this test site. And I am actually using Fillmore Central's information today because I received permission from him to do to work in the test site with his grant. So that's the first thing I do. I'm going to click GMS access after I get logged in. And hopefully my internet today is going to decide it wants to work. Awesome. Okay, so you will see that I'm in the 2021 year. And down here, it will show some available grants. Now, when you get in here, it may look like this and you're like, I don't see the grant. Well, click on this little triangle right here. And you will not have all of these options. You'll only have this option and it'll be minus one of these S's. In the test site, this is named wrong. So it's the CRRSA, ESSER II fund. So I'm gonna go ahead and create this document, or this grant, I should say, grant application. And so the first page is just a general information in regards to this. You'll notice this is a big question we get. The funds for this grant must be obligated by September 30th, 2023. So notice we're a couple years out from that. There's also a couple of really great tabs on this site that I would encourage you to look at. This one, Nebraska Frameworks document, you'll need when you get to the program information page. So that's worth looking at. This is a document that helps you think about renewal and acceleration and how some of the things you are going to do in your district will match in these different ways. So good tab, short document, easy to read and really makes sense. And then please click on the instructions. This should be the first place you go to if you have a question. Click on the instructions document. And maybe you're just stuck on the budget page. And so you can just very simply go to the spot that you need to go to based on the table of contents and find whatever you need to get you through. So that would be step one. So I encourage you to use both of those documents as you need to. Okay, so going left to right again, I'm gonna go straight across. This is the allocations and the contact information page. So you can see the allocations for your district will be on this page. There is nothing to do on this page. You're just going to look at it. In essence, know how much your dollars are, and that's what you're going to budget for. Contact information page. This page will have your DUNS number up here, as well as it's going to have two spots that have to be completed and a third spot that may be completed. And I'm going to stop for just a second and make sure Beth and Ron, are we taping this? Did we get this recorded? Awesome. Thank you. I see Beth's head shaking. Thanks. Okay, so here, this is authorized representative. I can tell you the majority of 99% of the districts in the state of Nebraska, that is the superintendent. So you'd input your name here and your phone number and your email. This is also the financial contact. Some districts, that's a superintendent. Some districts, it's a business manager or maybe a bookkeeper. So you'd input your name there, whatever you need to here. And then if there's someone else who's not is the contact person for the CRRSA ESSER II grant, you would click here and then put their information in here. But if there's not anyone else who's in charge of that, you would just leave that blank. So the very important thing to do is always save the page. So when I'm done here, I need to save page. And it was great because yesterday I forgot to save the page and I lost some info. So just keep telling yourself, save page. So that's this tab, allocations and contact information. Okay, so next tab is program information. Program information has all of the allowable uses for the ESSER $2. Now there are some additional allowances down here that were not in the CARES ESSER I application. So you'll want to look at those. There will also be a site on our website today on federal program site that will have a document that will show the comparison of CARES ESSER I money, CRRSA ESSER II money, and then ARP ESSER III money, which is the money that will be coming out later this summer and early fall. So what you need to do is you'll need to decide of the projects that we're doing that we've decided are most important for our kids and our school. You need to make sure that you select the same numbers on this page and they'll follow through on the budget. So if I mark any numbers on this page, they must go through to the budget. That was why a lot of grants were returned the first round, because people did not mark the right numbers on this page and then follow through to the budget. So for this example that I'm doing, and just so you guys know, I did this application the other night myself, like I was Fillmore Central, and it took me about 30, 45 minutes to complete it. It's not a long app to complete. So just FYI, if you know what you're gonna do, pretty easy to put that information in here. So what I did is I looked at this this document and I decided that the things I need to spend on are 2 and 10 and 11. And what happens is when I select those, I then get a text box underneath. And if I would try to save this page right now, it would not allow me to save the page because I don't have an explanation in here. So here I'm going to put a kindergarten teacher for additional support for students. And I'm going to put professional development around new curriculum materials. So that's just a quick explanation. Notice that it's only 500 is your max capacity. This isn't writing an essay. It's just giving a brief information about it. The next one for my example is I'm going to buy Chromebooks and I'm going to buy licenses for extended opportunities for kids. And that matches my professional development for teachers up above. And then the mental health support. As our district looked at our data and the kids that we're seeing, we decided that we need to hire an additional guidance counselor to support students, teachers, and families. So that's what I put there. So now I'm ready to save my page and I've written down that I've done 2, 10, and 11. So when I come to the budget page, I'm ready. So I'm gonna go ahead and save this page. And then I have no red errors up here, so I'm ready to move on. So again, I'm under program information, allowable uses, but I have another tab over here, which is intent and purpose. The intent and purpose pages are the questions that have to be answered for this grant. So the first one asks about your ESSER investments and how it's meeting the needs of English learners. So those historically marginalized students. It also has a B question, what data did you use? And it also has a C question, which will supports be provided to all students, specific groups, and so on. So I'm kind of one of those people that when I write an answer, I want to make sure I have all parts in the answer. So I've already composed it in a Word doc, and I'm just going to paste it in here. And what you'll notice, it's telling me that I'm over my word count because I have spaces in here. So I'm going to go back and take my spaces out. But notice what I did. I answered question A, I answered question B, and I answered question C. And I would continue to put the rest of that on there if this was a real application. And then the next question talks about how does it match that Nebraska Frameworks document? So again, that was a document I'd linked before. So I have already answered that question. And notice this is 500 characters. So again, this is not writing an essay. It's a pretty short answer, but I wanted to think back to what I'm spending my money on and then put that in here so it would make sense. And notice again, it's telling me that I'm over my max limit. So I'd have to go back and change some of my answers because this is only 500. Okay, how does this meet immediate and short-term needs or long-term needs, I should say? So again, I'm just going to copy and paste my answer. And then the last question is probably the most critical question of this entire application. As you've thought about how you're going to spend your ESSER II and even your ESSER III funds, we would encourage you to have a team of people help support that. We would encourage you to use the data from your students, not just MAPS data, but other data. Do you have some perception data? Do you have some, maybe your guidance counselor for this one, I could probably look at how many people my guidance counselor has seen this year and see that, hey, we need an additional guidance counselor to help support. So there's lots of data you can use for this one. So in this answer, this would be, if I was in a school district right now, this is what I would do in order to assure that we have the right things in place. So what I wrote is our school improvement team, which consists of teachers, classified staff, administrators, parents, two board members, and two community members, helped to design this plan for the use of ESSER II funds. We reviewed the data as listed in the answer to question 1B to determine our highest priority. So that's where you need to probably sit down with a group of people and think, what do we need to do and what data shows that? So once I get those four questions answered, I'm going to save page. And for those of you that have non-publics, you might have noticed that there's no non-public information. I think the majority of you probably know the non-public grant funds are in a different pool, so you don't have to deal with that this round. So you did in CARES 1, in CRRS A2, you do not have to deal with non-publics. So again, this is only public information. Okay, I'm going to keep rolling. I don't see Ann interrupting, so we'll keep going. The next page is the staff and equipment page, and these pages look identical to what you've seen in the past if you've completed any sort of grant in the GMS for federal funds. There are four tabs, an instructional staff tab, a non-instructional staff tab, so those people who work with kids or work in the school but don't necessarily aren't your classroom teachers, your operational equipment page, and your capital assets page. The one thing you're going to see on here in blue is really, really important. If the district is budgeting funds for salaries, funds must also be budgeted on the budget page. Notice budget page, not on this page, for employee benefits at a comparable rate. So for my example that I'm giving, remember I'm hiring that new kindergarten teacher and I'm hiring Arnold Schwarzenegger. And for him, his salary is, and I'm going to put in what I know his salary is, and it's for next year. So I'm putting in that, and I'm hiring him as a one, I'm paying all of his dollars, all of his funding with this ESSER II money. And so then over there, I'd put $48,400. Now, if this was only 75% of it was funding, then I'd have to take $48,400 times 75% to get this amount to go here. Notice this is without benefits or extracurricular. So no benefits go on this page, no extracurricular go on this page in either one of the columns. And then for the example that I'm providing, I'm also going to provide stipends to teachers, and it's going to be district-wide. And I've set aside $2710 for that. And I'm not going to put a percentage in here because it wouldn't make sense to have that because it's several teachers that are going to do this. And that's so we can do our professional development around our new curriculum materials. Beth?
Yep. I was just going to say, if you do stipends, you want to put a zero in there, or you're going to get an error.
So, okay. Yep.
And okay, then if you were going to fund him a second year, so for example, you only have the first year in here, but you have enough funds that you want to fund him for 2 years, since this grant goes all the way to September 30 of 2023, you would need to list him a second time.
Yep.
We don't want you to put it all together as one, because we want to be able to go into NSSRS and double check that.
Good point. And just so you know, with Arnold, I would probably put, unless you've got a contract with your teachers for the next 2 years and it's already signed, I'd put the same amount. And then you could do an amendment later to put that amount based on the increase in salary for the following year. So keep that in mind. And then just a reminder, you do need to do time and effort for Arnold. So remember, Arnold needs to do time and effort because he's being paid with federal funds. And I'm going to go to Ann, because I think Ann has a question that goes with this page.
So is summer school hourly pay similar to stipends? That's the question.
And the answer to that is yes. Yep. So that would be stipends. So this is what I was doing. I was looking at this. It's, you know, $135 a day for so many teachers. So good question.
Actually, okay. Donnie, I would prefer that they put summer, maybe instead a to be determined.
Okay.
And then a hyphen and then summer. And then when they know who those staff are later on, they could do an amendment to give the names, because they will have to provide names for summer school. We won't see summer school on NSSRS, but we will expect to see on here how much is paid. So if you're going to just budget a certain amount for summer school, you would want to determine that.
Okay.
And then a follow-up is, do they need time and effort for summer school?
Yes. We have to do time and effort anytime there is your funding staff. So a summer school stipend might just be the week that they're teaching summer school. So it would be the days they worked, the hours they worked, and supervisor signature at the end of the week. So it would just be a par for a week or 2 weeks or however long it lasts.
Good questions. Okay, so I'm going to go ahead and calculate my totals. This is important to do on this page, and then I'm going to write this amount down, because when I get to the budget page, I have to account for these dollars, this $51,110. So remember, that's strictly for salaries. That does not include benefits. And then the one thing I always manage to do is I always calculate the totals, but I forget to hit save page. So again, save your page so it's there when you come back. Okay, so then I'm going to go to my non-instructional staff page. And with my non-instructional staff page, the person I'm going to put on my non-instructional staff page is my new counselor. And maybe I don't have that new counselor hired, so I could say to be hired if I have not hired them yet for the following year. And it's going to be in all buildings. And I'm going to pull down and figure out where that person fits. And then I'm going to do... I'm going to pay 1.0, so I'm going to do 100% of this person's salary. And for my example, I'm just going to, I think his counselor probably will be high on the salary, so I'm going to put that person in as $63,000. So again, then I'd calculate totals. Remember, I'm going to come back and make sure this is on the budget page. The $63,000 is critical to carry over to the budget page. And then I'm going to save page. One of the things that I want to just point out once again is notice that this person is to be hired. I'm going to eventually have to do an amendment and put that person's name and put that person's actual salary. It's okay to do amendments with these. Remember, these funds are lasting for the next 2 years, about 2.5 years. So we understand that districts will make changes and want to spend their dollars in different ways. Perfectly okay. Keep, if amendments are needed, do the amendments. Okay, so go ahead.
I was just going to point out there is an upload. So if you are doing stipends, you could upload the staff that are being paid with stipends. You could upload if you're doing substitutes. You could upload that information later. So I just wanted to point that out also.
Awesome. And Ann? Well,
follow-up question. How would you list a full-time substitute teacher?
Back on the instructional staff page. And you would know full-time staff or full-time substitute, you should know her name. So you'd put her here. If she's district, elementary, middle school, high school, wherever, and then whatever you are paying her him or her, I should say. And then it's 1.0 here, and then the same thing. So go on this page. Okay, so I'm gonna go to operational equipment page. And for my operational equipment page, these are the directions as to what you should list on this page. So I like to think of these as things that could actually get up and walk out of your building in somebody's book bag or a teacher's bag or whatever. So you want to keep track of them. We also encourage districts that anything that has a serial number should be something listed on this page. So remember back to my example, I said we were going to buy some Chromebooks. So I put the Chromebooks here. And it's going to be district-wide at all schools. I can't just put them in one school because we need them everywhere. And the cost is $300. And I'm going to purchase 500 of these. So when I calculate my total, notice it's $150,000. So some people think, oh, that has to go on the capital assets because it's more than $5,000 total. It does not. Look at your unit cost. If your unit cost is more than $5,000, that needs to be on the capital assets page. If it's under $5,000, it belongs on this page. So you can add additional entries if you need to on this page. So if I have many things to do, or if you have it in a file and you just want to upload the file, you can do that as well. So you could have all of this information in some sort of a chart and upload it. Just make sure that you have Chromebooks, the location, the unit cost, the quantity, and the calculated totals. Okay, so again, I'm going to save the page, pretty critical. And then the next page is the capital assets page. For my example, I don't have anything to put on the capital assets page, but this page is pretty critical. If you are purchasing something with federal funds, which ESSER II are federal funds, and it costs the one item costs $5,000 or more, you must get prior written approval from Beth. So here is Beth's email address. And what you need to do is send her an email, put in the subject line, written approval, prior written approval for ESSER II is fine, whatever you put in the subject line. And then just do a brief explanation to her about what it is you are wanting to purchase that costs more than $5,000. And she will look at those and she will respond to those one by one and give you permission. Now, something that we have just found out in the last 2 days, lucky us, is that if you do any sort of a construction or remodeling project of any sort, and it costs more than $2,000, and you're using these federal funds, you have to follow something called the Davis-Bacon Act. And the Davis-Bacon Act is, kind of a, I don't want to say a contract, but it's an agreement between the school district and whomever is doing the work that says that that company will follow all of the rules necessary in order to assure that all Davis-Bacon Act wages are being paid accordingly. So there's a few things you have to do that are in addition to what you typically do with a simple construction project in your district. So when Beth returns it, if it has anything to do with construction and she returns the approval, she'll add information, attachments on there about Davis-Bacon Act and what you need to do and how that works. You may even have to contact your attorney's office. I can tell you that Perry Law Firm, we talked to Justin Knight about this, so he understands this. I'm assuming KSB will understand this as well. I just don't know who their contact is for that particular thing. But really, really important that you follow that. Again, it's because these are federal dollars. So we have to make sure that you're jumping through every hoop you need to in order to not have to pay back the money down the road. Let's do things right the first time. So again, send those to her. Beth, now that we have the answers, Beth will be working on responding to those of you that have asked for some operational or some capital asset purchases. Mm-hmm. She'll be working on that in the next few days to get those responses back to you. Okay. Beth, did you want to add anything else about Davis-Bacon? Those are our two favorite words right now.
Yeah. just that you'll need to follow it. Dottie, you did a great job of answering that. There was a question on curriculum, and while curriculum will cost a lot, the individual breakdown of like the books or the licenses is under 5,000. So you will put that in the 600s, not in the 700s. And so it does not need to go on capital assets.
Okay. Which made me think of another thing. We did have a question the other day about, okay, so if I'm doing a project and it costs, let's say $25,000, maybe I'm remodeling a classroom to open it up more for kids to be more spread out. If you are doing something like that, just keep in mind that, now I lost my train of thought, Beth, what was I going to say with that? I'm forgetting. I'll think of it, but just go ahead, Beth.
I would say probably that the full amount goes in the 700.
Thank you.
Don't have to break it down.
Thank you. It's been a long week. That's exactly right. So yes, you don't have to break it down by how much of this project is actual labor, how much of it is paint and carpet and so on. You just have to have an overall amount, and it does go in the 700s on the budget, and it would go on this capital assets page for this example because it costs more than $25,000. Okay. And so as I go to Anne, I just have to apologize because I have two English bulldogs in my house, and one of them is sleeping under my desk right now, and she is snoring loudly. So if you hear that, it's not my stomach. Go ahead, Anne.
So another really good question, is it expected that the next round of federal money will be allowed for the same uses? And I think you guys do want to talk about the 20% of the ESSER III.
Great question. Yeah, there will be on our website that document that I talked about earlier that will it's done in columns. So column one talks about ESSER I, column two ESSER II, and column three ESSER III. So it will show exactly what is and isn't allowable. One of them that is going away, and I'm going to just go back for just a minute to program information. Number four, providing principals and other school leaders with the resources necessary to address the needs of their individual schools. That one is not on ESSER III. That one is going away. And then there's an additional one, number 17, that's being added that has to do with working with your local health agency for mitigation of virus type. Otherwise, everything is still on for ESSER III that's on ESSER II, except for this one and the addition.
And then another question about HVAC. So if they're not doing a remodel, it's not really a remodel, do they still follow Davis-Bacon?
Yes. Yes. HVACs count as having to follow Davis-Bacon. Any new construction, remodeling, renovation, anything like that is a yes. We were
and
trying
can
hard
we put
to
the
get...
website. Can we put the website for that? Oh, good. Thanks, Beth.
Awesome. Okay. Okay, so now I'm going to go on to, I've been to the staff equipment page, so now I'm going to go to the budget page. Now remember the budget page, there were two really important things for me to remember. Whatever I put back here on intent and purpose, I have to match my function codes. So back on that page, I use number 2, I use number 10, and I use number 11. So because I use those three, I have to make sure that I put money over here. Now notice somebody will be like, well, there's only three spots. If I did six of them, I could create additional entries. So you can keep adding more entries. It adds three at a time and to get all of yours in there. So the one thing here is, and then the second piece I need to remember is how much I put on those staff pages. So I put this amount on the staff page for salaries for my kindergarten teacher and my professional development. Now, thinking of that, remember, I have to use employee benefits. I have to put that in here as well. So based on what I know about Arnold and how much he's going to use for insurance and FICA and retirement, and what I'm going to have to pay those teachers for their summer PD work, I know that I'm going to be roughly about $26,480. So there is my money for that line. My technology, remember how much I had in technology? I had that $150,000. So that has to be here, but I also need those site licenses. Now I didn't put site licenses back on my page when I did my equipment because that's not something somebody can steal. They're just actually on the computer. So with my site licenses and my Chromebooks, I'm thinking roughly I'm gonna spend about $176,300. And then down here, this would be my guidance counselor. So I guessed my guidance counselor was that. amount, and I'm going to go high end on this, assuming that this guidance counselor will take full family insurance. So I'm going to go high there, and with all of the retirement and FICA. And so that's the amount I put there. And then my guidance counselor really does need some supplies to get that program going. So I'm going to give them $5,000. So I would do all of that, figure out my budget. I'd calculate my totals. And I want this to be zero. So I know it's zero. Now, some districts have asked about, well, what about, can you take indirect costs on this grant? Yes, you can take indirect costs. This amount right here is varied for each district. So you'd have to look at your personal grant to know how much you can take. So in this case, if I was Fillmore Central and decided I want to take indirect costs, I could put in the 2811 here. I could take the full amount. I could take less than that. But for this demonstration, I'll take it all. And now I'm 2811 over in my budget. So I would have to take that $5,000 is probably the best place to take it off. And so now I've just reduced the supplies for my new counselor. Now they don't have as much money. And now I'm going to calculate my totals. And now I've spent all of my dollars. Now, the one important thing, and write this down a million times, put it on your computer, save page, because I have it all figured out. I don't want to lose it. And then the next page is the budget summary page. And the budget summary page literally is just a quick chart of what I put on the budget page. So you can look at that and see where you did everything. The last, really, honestly, the last page has several tabs, but they're not difficult tabs. It's just material for you to read. This first one is common assurances. So this lists information that you need to read and agree to. The next page, and then you'll click the checkbox up here. The next page is a standard agreement clause. Same thing. I'm just going to read through it and agree to all of that. The third page is the program assurances, and this deals strictly with CRRSA funds. So I'm going to read through that and agree to it. So I'll check there. And then the last page is the assurance summary page. And for the assurance summary page, I'm going to go ahead and click that I agree with all of this. And then the last page on this tab is the GEPA information page. And what I want to do is I'm going to share on our website, there will be a sample GEPA statement for you to look at. For those of you that wrote the first CARES grant, you will have an example of a GEPA. It's just you need to make sure that you follow certain directions in regards to that GEPA statement. So I'm going to just show you the one I wrote for this. So this is a separate document, but this will explain on our website what a GEPA statement is and a GEPA statement is not. But here's what I wrote, how I wrote my GEPA statement. I just simply put the name of my school district we're going to use, really critical to put the right funding that you're going to use, the CRRSA Act, ESSER II funds, for, and then I just bulleted them. I put here my subgroups that I'm not going to deny participation to any of those subgroups. And then I just did a really quick paragraph about each of those up here that were starred and what I'm going to use my dollars for. And that's an appropriate GEPA statement. So once again, if you want to see a copy of that, that will be on our website for you to look at. It'll be at the top of the federal program site. Okay, so I have to upload that GEPA statement. So for this, I'm going to upload something that's not my GEPA, but I'm going to upload it. And I'm going to save my page. Go ahead.
I was just going to point out that the assurances have to be agreed to by the superintendent or the authorized rep. So if the bookkeeper's filling this out, make sure that the soup does read them or the authorized rep does read these, because they're the one that is going to be held liable if they don't follow the assurances. So
good point. Thank you, Beth.
They read things.
And notice that I got a red error when I tried to save my page because I forgot to check the box saying that the district does have a GEPA statement and then I've uploaded it. So I need to click that and save my page. Now, the very last thing that you have to do on the application is click the submit button. And with the submit button, you must run a consistency check first to see if you made any errors, if there's anything you have to go back and fix. So there has to be no red errors on here before you can approve it. So as that runs, I would just add a couple of things. We've had a lot of questions from districts about paying staff. We just would like to remind you guys that when you think about those allowable, the program information, the allowable uses, and I'm going to go back there. When you look at that, think about how these funds that you're receiving really fit under those. And really, it's what are you doing in addition? So it's not just, hey, I'm going to pay my kindergarten teacher because I just want another kindergarten teacher. I'm going to pay that kindergarten teacher because I know my kids lost out in preschool for 3 months in the previous school year. I know that we need to spread kids out more. And I know that we need to give those kids a really good foundation. So I can justify why that addition is appropriate to use with these dollars. Okay, so just some things to keep in mind. And then if you look back to the submit page, it does say that it says assurances must be reviewed and approved. So here's what I forgot to do. So it's not going to let me submit this application. What I forgot to do back on this assurance page is I clicked the top button, but I didn't save the page. So I need to go through after I've read all of these, and I need to go through all three of them. Okay, so I need to make sure that I am going through and saving the page on each one of those. So that was the error that I have in order to stop me from submitting this application. So it's checked, but it's not saved. And now I should be able to go through and the assurance summary. I think I saved that page, but I'm just going to double check. So I check that. And there's no save button. So if I would uncheck that, I will get a red error. So I'm going to check it. And then I'm going to go back to my submit page and I have to unlock the application. And I'm going to run the consistency check one more time and make sure that I'm ready to submit. Okay, Beth, do you want to share anything that I forgot?
I think you've covered it. I was going to say, if you don't have a save button, often it's because you've locked down the grant. So if you've run the consistency check and you don't have a save button at the bottom of the page, you'll have to hit that unlock. If a grant is returned to you and you, lots of times districts are like, I can't get into the grant, you'll have to click over on the page lock control to unlock a grant there. So there are some different things that when a grant is locked down, ways you have to open it. So just wanted to be sure to point that out.
Good statement. Everybody says, and I'm terrible. I help districts and then they're typing stuff and it's like, there's no save button. There's no save button if you did not unlock your pages. I do that a lot, so. Okay, so I'm gonna stop sharing